All right. Alhamdulillah, wa sallam wa rasulullah. It's an honor and a moment of happiness and joy to be with you here in Pakistan, in Islamabad, in Muslim Aid. We should value all our organizations, no matter how big or small, new or old organizations. So I'm very, very honored to be with you today, and I'm thanking Brother Shah Nawaz and Brother Asif Shirazi for letting me to have the opportunity to be with you, not vice versa, not otherwise. Why you are here? Why you are here? If we decide to work in this field, we should have a declaration, a decree to say that we are servants. We are servants. We are servants, and to believe in it, not just to say it as lip service, and to believe in it. Once you believe in it, you act on it. Because you are here to make the positive change. You are here to become a change maker. You are here to empower people, to protect the resources, to widen the vision of the people for living in the locality. You are not here just for the logo, or for the title, or for the salary. Professor Al-Sallam was like any one of you before the Quran revealed upon him. That's why when the Quran revealed upon the Prophet Al-Sallam, he came shaking to Bibi Khadija. I keep saying this story many times. Who laid down the foundation of social work and humanitarian work. And she told him, Allah will never let you down. Why? Because he's very good to his family, Silat al-Rahim. He's helping the needy, empowering the less fortunate, and building community. And this is your prophetical message. In the teaching of Khadija to the Prophet ﷺ, at the time when he was made a prophet, this is characteristic before he became a prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you are here for the salary, out. Find salary somewhere else. If you are here for the position or the CV, out. You'll get it somewhere else. If you are here to become a boss, out. The only one who can make us boss are those people in the locality. Yesterday I was talking in Quetta, and one of the people in the audience told me the Egyptians have good sense of humor. Why you are not giving jokes and others? I couldn't be able to respond to him to upset him. But after what I have seen for only 2 days in Derbandin and this area in the villages, I could not be able to smile. It's a shame on me. As a humanitarian worker, it's a shame on me as Pakistani to see my fellow Pakistani citizens are living in this situation. And I'm claiming that I am the one who is bringing happiness to people. You want people to be happy? Be with them. You want to be the boss? Let the people who need the service to make you the boss. And you be boss forever. Humanitarian work, development work, is not about just making a project. It's about changing the lifestyle of the people, empowering them, giving them ownership, educating them, giving them the rights. It goes beyond the food handout. We become sick of handout of food. and Facebook images and Twitter and others. We become very sick of this. Let us come out to see the reality. And I believe in each and every one of you, by the way. Each and every one of you. That you will be able to make it. Switch your heart, discover your potential, and leave the risk for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the only one who will make you boss, and the only one who will make you happy, and the only one who will bring barakah to each and every one of you, to yourself, to your family, to the surrounding, is this poor individual. This widow and the orphan, they have the blessing on us. We don't shower our blessing on them. They spend their money on us as salaries, as per diem, as holidays, as education fees for our children. This is their money. It's not our money. This is their money, including the donor. The donor is entrusted to have this money with him or her to give it to the right people, because this is haqq, lissail wal mahroom, to the deprived and the gharib, and the people who ask for help. Don't ever and never think that you are the boss. You are a boy, young girl, with sticky eyes, with running nose, with barefooted, and looking miserable. He is the one who will save each and every one of us and say, please Allah, save Asif, because he helped me sincerely, not as a show, not as a glamour and an image, because he did not use me as a number, as a figure, as a box of food, a pair of shoes. Sometimes we change the feeling and the human feeling of the people who pay our salary and spend their money on us as numbers, as pairs of shoes, number of trousers. We don't realize that we are talking to human being with number one. Number two, I am a Pakistani, okay? Very proud of this. No doubt. I'm very proud of my country, of my culture, of my history, and I'm rich man and rich woman, rich citizen. For two reasons. First of all, Allah has created me to be the best as a human being of His creation. He gave me the mind, the health, the knowledge, everything. So never let anyone or anybody to let you to feel that you are miserable or you are poor. As an individual, you are extremely rich because you are Khalifatullah fil ard. You are the custodian of Allah on earth. And Allah will never make a custodian for him unless he or she has the ability to lead and make the change. It's number one. Number two, my country is not a poor country. My country is an extremely rich country. Whether it's Pakistan, or it's Indonesia, or whether it's Malaysia, or it's Egypt, whatever you call it. And Allah has put natural resources inside the country to be sufficient for 1,000 years to come. Even if our population becomes 500 million. Because in his knowledge, he knew how many people will live on this piece of land after 1,000 years. So he put the resources for you to discover it, to utilize it, to manage it, and to use it. So never let anyone to tell you that you are miserable, you are poor, you are a waste of time, and never let any one of you to feel that your country is poor. Never. And if you sit down now and look at the resources of our country here, for us, incredible resources. It needs good management. Yes, number two. Number three, if I'm talking to you about a solution, I'm not going to put a magic solution because I failed 2 days ago when I was putting a solution in Dalbandin, which was a very stupid suggestion for myself. A parachute solution, is that right, brother Asif?
Solution was to have the market in around these villages or in between these villages. And the population, when you saw the villages by themselves, you saw that the population of each village is just 10 houses or 15 people or 4 or 5 houses. So that was a parachute solution given by someone who came from England.
With
a
stupid, doesn't have
having,
knowledge.
Having OBE title also.
But it's still stupid.
I can't say this thing.
No, I can say it. I can say ignorant, stupid, and arrogant. Because I think that, I came from UK, you have to listen to me. Why?
Yeah.
You have the knowledge better than myself. The third one, if I can ask all of you one question. If we can divide our resources in the country, how many sectors you can have? Now we are looking at, give me the flip chart, brother. Give me the flip chart, please. And do you have a pen? A markup?
Yeah, please.
This is the map of our resources. Tell me how many parts inside this map. What resources we have? Just give the name.
Water.
Water. Natural resources?
Natural
resources, okay. How many percent the natural resources? 5%, 20%, 30%? Natural resources will show everything. Water, minerals, climate, all these sort of things.
70%,
okay. What other resources?
Man-made resources.
Sorry?
Man-made.
Human
resources? Human. How much? There's 70% here. How much human resources?
10%.
What else?
Financial resources.
What do you mean by financial resources?
Like how much money do we have as a
Okay, now we have human resources, we have natural resources. What other resources?
Either a human made resource.
Okay, there's two. Khalas, finish. We'll finish with this.
It should be 30%.
Whatever it is, we're going to change it, okay.
Yeah.
You said that only two resources. How about your history? How about your culture? How about your values? Okay. Isn't it a resources?
Yes.
Okay. So what will you put this as? A title? History, culture, values, what do you call it? Because you are highly educated than myself. I'm a street worker. I'm not like you, very handsome man.
This is some kind of knowledge.
What do you call it? Knowledge?
Yes.
What do you call it in a proper way? Because you are the people of tomorrow. What do you call this? History, culture, values?
Social resources.
Okay, social. How much you give it?
10%,
okay. What else? Brothers and sisters, you are the present leaders and the future leaders. You have to guide me and lead me and educate me. I'm not here to lecture you. I'm here to learn from you. 70% natural, 10% human, 10% social. We have another 10%. Think outside your box. Can you give any name to this 10%? Like contingency, like future, like whatever you call it. Something which you don't discover, but you give a space for it. a thing could be right or wrong.
Continental.
Huh? What is the social? What in any budget?
Contingency.
Huh?
Contingency or
contingency?
ICR, agency management score.
Okay. Here you decided that natural resources is more important than human resources. Who is going to manage the natural resources? If I have got unqualified human resources, I'll have corruption here. I'll have mismanagement here. Natural resources is here, or are here, to be managed by those people. So the best investment is in here, in the human resources. That's why the first word being revealed on the Prophet ﷺ was Iqra. Not only read, Iqra is about the knowledge. And beyond the knowledge, not the literacy of reading and writing. So if we don't have a proper human resources, qualified and educated, we cannot manage our natural resources. So coming back to what I want to say as a message, two things. First of all, our country needs a lot of help. I came from Balochistan yesterday or this morning, and they were telling me about Sindh and the dry seasons and what they call it, the drought life, which can lead to a disaster in the future. This big area, and if you talk about Balochistan as about 40 to 50% of the size of the country, of the area, with very, very scarce number of people, you see how difficult it is. And the other one is sin. It's number one. Can we, and this we must do it, where is the logo of Muslim Aid? Give me anything I can show you. All right. The logo is here.
It's there.
Okay. Don't ever worship the logo.
Okay.
Don't ever make the logo the issue. Don't ever fight for the size of the logo or the color of the logo, or our logo should be in the front page or the cover page, not the back page. It's a time that organizations should sit down together and think collectively for the bigger issue. The issue in Balochistan, the issue in Sindh, the issue in any other area. More important than the logo of Islamic League, the logo of Muslim Aid, the logo of Human Appeal, and any other logo. If we don't clean this piece of meat in our heart, we are not going to be successful. And we are not going to be the boss. Because the young boys and girls in this area will dislike us. And do not make a dua for Allah to make barakah in our work. So now we are going to another area of becoming the collective, to work together and to make a sort of consortium to enable us to fight the poverty and the drought in this area as well as in other areas in Pakistan and outside Pakistan. This is number one. So the collectiveness is a must at the moment. Second one is human resources. If we think that how many million now? What, more than 2 million? 200 million?
Pakistan?
Yeah?
Yeah,
220 million. Yeah. 220 million. Bismillah mashallah. How many young men and women will be among the 220 million?
60%.
You talk about 100 million? Source of energy and power of vision and drive, and we are not utilizing them because we think that in our offices we are the best to do that. We do not think that the youth will make a revolution of social change in our country. When I start to utilize their potentials and let them to go instead of being used by the social media, to use the social media to come to find the solution for the people in Balochistan, in KPK, in Sindh, and other places. As I said, the wealth is under my feet. It's here. But I look at a foreign agency. I look at a foreign government to give me a peanut condition. Condition peanut could change my culture one day, could change my philosophy of thinking one day, could change my values one day, whether it's a Muslim or non-Muslim. Even some of the Muslim organizations bring their fiqh, which can divide the country. Unfortunately. I'm not just going to be biased to one side, not to the other side. While the wealth, the enormous wealth, is underneath my feet. You know what's the difference between us and the West? They know how to manage the resources. They have the data. They know how to manage the data. Give me the top 10 companies on earth. What are they? Which background? The top? Huh? Apple. Yes, one.
Microsoft.
GMC.
Huh? GMC. Communication. Information.
Alibaba.
Google. When you look at this, they have the information that we provide them freely. But they manage to store it, to classify it, to sell it, and promote it from my raw material. And I have this in this room. I've got maybe 20 people or 25 people. The wealth of the knowledge you have at the back of your mind is more precious than the £1 million or £2 million that you are seeking to take from a foreign donor. And if you have this, human resources, I said more than 100 million young people, how can we utilize them and make them the advocate and make them the fundraiser and make them the social worker and make them the social reformer and make them the social leader for the future and hand out the stick to them to lead. I was working with Shah Nawaz and with Brother Asif Shirazi and Umair and Sikandar Ali as well, if you know him, and Jangir Malik. Alhamdulillah, in my life, they became leaders. In your life, you have to create leaders. Cannot afford to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without leaving behind. We don't want to believe in legacies. Your legacy will be in the leadership of the youth, the young people, when you leave behind them, when you leave them behind you. It's what we need to have at the back of our mind, that the wealth is inside Pakistan. The wealth in human resources. The wealth in the young generation. The wealth in our love and the caring for our country. The wealth is in our humility to the people who paid our salaries. The wealth in the barakah of those people who can stand before Allah and tell them Allah will love Muslim aid. Allah will love human appeal. Allah will love Muslim hands. So Allah will make your action full of barakah. It's not something you measure by a matrix. It's something measured by the matrix of Allah, which is unmeasurable. Your matrix is according to our ability to think, which is limited. But the matrix of Allah is unimaginable. And it is that will lie in the hand of whom? Of those young, miserable looking, sick-eyed boys and girls who are orphans. That's why I need to conclude because I talk too much. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Ma'un, if anybody hafiz Surah Al-Ma'un, he put on one side of the scale the people who deny the day of judgment. On the other side of the scale, the people who treat orphans badly. The people who treat orphans badly will be exactly like the people who deny the day of judgment. Allah knows that the most vulnerable individual in the society is the orphan boy or girl. If we look miserably at him or her, we will be considered like we deny the day of judgment. Not only that, which is very important, the one I'm going to talk about now, is what? Is advocacy, which is not on our table, not on our agenda, is not in our program, is not our structure in the organization. It was in the structure of Islam and the Book of Allah from day one. This is the second part in Surah Ma'un. الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ فَالَّذِي يَكَذِّبُ يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ The one who treats orphan badly and the one who does not promote the needs of the needy. Which is what? Advocacy. Where are our organizations from the advocacy? وَلَا يَحُدُّ عَلَى طَعَامٍ مِسْكِينٍ Does not the word the had. Had is to spread the news of the needs of the needy. In Yemen, in Pakistan, in Syria, in Iraq, in Myanmar, in South Sudan, in DRC, everywhere. Allah did not say the needy Muslims. Allah did not say the orphan Muslim, the Muslim orphans. Allah said, وَلَا يَحُدُّ عَلَى طَعَامٍ مِسْكِينٍ The miskeen may be a dua from non-Muslim woman can be accepted to you because you draw a smile on her face. Advocacy is a cornerstone in Islam. And treating the most vulnerable individual in the community is a cornerstone in Islam as well. And this is the foundation which was Bibi Khadija was talking to the Prophet ﷺ about it when he was declared a Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Jibreel came upon him with the Quran Iqra. Knowledge. The knowledge being managed by Google, by Facebook, by others, creates hundreds of billions of dollars from the data you give them. And the most importantly here is to go back to our human resources. Social work, humanitarian work, and developmental work is not a job. It's a mission, it's a message, it's a vision. It's a lifelong mission and message. You take it to be elevated by the angels of the, in the hand in the front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You leave it, you'll be elevated by somebody living in your society, but not by the angels who will defend you, but not by the young orphans and male and female who will elevate you. Elevation before Allah inside His matrix is by the people who smile at your face because you changed their life. Never think that you are the one who brought the money to Muslim Aid. Never think that you are the one, we are the one who built Muslim Aid. The one who built Muslim Aid is the poor people who are making dua day and night to make your mission successful. Without their partnership, we cannot succeed. Without their partnership, we cannot achieve. We cannot be partnership, we cannot change their life to a better life. So always, always, always make partnership with them. That's why when the Prophet ﷺ was asked by Hazrat Jibreel, you want to make a king prophet or a slave prophet? He said, Allahumma hashurni fi zumrat al-masakin. Oh Allah, put me amongst, even not to be notified, amongst the miskeen. And he was the leader or the imam of all the prophets and messengers of God. But he decided to be with the people who are very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The people who make constitute the majority of the people in heaven. The people who go to heaven 500 years before wealthy people like yourself. The people when they ask Allah for something, Allah will respond swiftly. Respond to rain, to prevent disasters. The people who are Allah is putting them as a test in our life to see how can we deal with them. Allahumma ahshurni. Allahumma make me amongst the miskeen. And this is what we need to be with the miskeen to change the life of them and to be their servants. I conclude by saying, if you want to become a servant, raise your hand. You came late, but we accept you. Did you raise your hand? I'm not forcing you to raise your hand.
He can't understand English.
Oh, okay, fine. Any man in Urdu?
Yes. He's an office boy, so he
does Urdu.
Urdu.
अपना हाथ उठाएं अगर आप servant बनना चाहते हैं मुस्लिम एट की काम
खादम बनना चाहते हैं
दूसरे चाइस भी देना
खादम खिला By the way, in this room, there's thousands of angels looking at your hand and telling Allah, we have been with the people of Muslim Aid today, and every one of them is submitting himself or herself to the servitude of your servants, your vulnerable people. Please accept them. And Allah knows. And He will make you a servant. If the people, the poor people, wish that you become a servant. Allah will never appoint us as servants unless the vulnerable people will tell Allah, we want him. We want her. So an appointment by a prime minister or a king or a president or a minister is appointment by the miskeen, by the gharib, by the orphans, by the widow, by the displaced, by the refugees, by the sick, by the elderly. And this is the matrix of Allah. Stick to the matrix of Allah, so Allah will elevate you to be amongst the al-anbiya wal-mursaleen wal-salihin. Say ameen. Jazakum Allah khair. May Allah bless you. Thank you for every one of you submitted his paper to the authority of Allah, to the angels, to become what? A servant.
Sir.
Don't withdraw it. Don't withdraw it. Angels, sort him out. They are looking at you. Look at them. No, look at this one. No, seriously, they are here.
Yes, exactly.
No, don't look at me, look at them. Allah bless you, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.
You have a rich history of setting up global organizations. And I'm sure in this process you have come across a lot of challenges. We also have our own set of challenges here in Pakistan currently as a humanitarian sector, both in terms of getting operational access and also in terms of understanding the sector, how it has evolved, you know, of late. And we sometimes consider ourselves to be behind the other organizations and not playing the game the way it should be. So if you can share some of your practical experience, because whenever I attend your sessions, maybe the way you explain the jargons and the acronyms that we are comfortable using in this sector is very different from the way it's put in the papers and a lot of, you know, documents that we see around. So,
okay. I think if you look back at the last 30, 40 years, there's something that you do before you believe it's right. Give you an example. When Chechnya war started in December 1994, we didn't have any vision to go and work in Chechnya. But we sent somebody in the middle of the snow, minus 20 or 30, was Sakandar Ali and Mustafa Osman. Allah opened the gates because of your heart is linked to His matrix. You know what they found there when they were in Grozny? NBC. And the one who was running NBC at the time was one of our friends. They were the only organization, the name has been mentioned globally, that they are in Grozny. So when you took the decision to be with the people, the most difficult area, in the middle of the snow, even before having an office, Allah send you somebody to notify your action. So this calculated afterwards. This one issue, which you take the risk. Humanitarian work is about risk taking. Not about just keeping calculating the risk. By the time you keep calculating and finishing it, the problem is over. This is number one. Number two, in the issue of Lebanon, 2006. We don't have any budget. Any budget. And I was going from one place to another place. Then incidentally, I found Al Jazeera on the same road. I acted like an actor. Came out with the Egyptian humor, okay, sense of humor. And I showed them my back, which is the logo. And the representative of Al Jazeera TV came out and said, "You are so and so." I asked, "Oh yes, I am. Oh, who are you?" I'm trying to tell him that I don't know Al Jazeera. They bought us, they told us we're going to record with you. Okay? I said, "Okay, fine." We went to a bunker where one or two families were there, and they told me, "Speak." Wallahi, the way I spoke for about 8 or 9 minutes, I could not have repeated it again. At all. At all. And you know what, brothers and sisters? This was live on the main news. And instantly, one donor bought about $250,000 or euros at that time. If you take the risk for your life to try to save people's life, you don't think in a split of a second that you'll be more generous to them than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another incident, we're digging a well in Niger. And when the water was coming out, everybody was jubilant. Allah told us, "Okay, fine. You brought the water from this point." By the time we finished getting the water out from the well, the rain came down because we made the rain prayer, istisqa. And it took us about 4 hours to come out from the field to reach the office. So when you risk your life for others, you have to realize, in this difficult situation, sometimes you calculate, sometimes you don't calculate. Because being there, even if you cannot do anything, this will give the people the feeling that there's somebody remembering them. Somebody is with them now. Now. Not after a month or 2 or 6 months. Now. When everybody is running. And this is the beauty about swift humanitarian response. Not based on how much money we need to get from an international agency, but how much effort to make to put our heart with their heart in the field at the same time when they are stuck with it. Things happen like this in Bosnia. Things happen like this when we did not discriminate between Muslims and non-Muslims. Even with the fake in 1991. Well, everybody in UK was talking, shall we support Shia or not? We were before even the Shia themselves. And at the time, we were very little organization. So when there's a humanitarian need, do not think. The only thing you think about is to be with those people. To alleviate how much, doesn't matter how much. Just try to do as much as you can, even if it's little. But do it from the heart. Do it for the people who are actually going to be paying our salary in this issue. Many examples, but I can talk to you tomorrow. But yeah, unless I did not answer your question, or you want some more?
Yeah, the other half of the question was about how do we adapt to the sector and the changing trends and the demands.
The changing trends is, don't bank only on humanitarian response and the easy way of fundraising. Because community building is more important. Development is more important. Advocacy is more important. Research is more important. If we look at the sector, the growth of the sector, we have to climb. That's why one of the things, Brother Nawaz, Shah Nawaz, I always say Shah Nawaz Sharif or Nawaz Sharif. I met him many times. From 1999. Yeah, and Albania.
Albania.
I have to rise. Build my organization to rise above the level of just humanitarian response. Okay? This is very important. I have to structure my organization internally to look at the needs of the community. In the good old days, we never talked about community building, we never talked about peace building, we never talked about a peace negotiation, we never talked about advocacy 15, 20 years. This should be basic of what we do nowadays. Connection with the others. Empowerment of women and young people. It's something it's in Islam. But why you are not doing it? I was discussing something yesterday. Oh, shouldn't discuss it in Pakistan. Anyway, let me discuss it. I have no problem. Young girl like Malala. Okay, she was hit. Okay? By whatever you call it. Was it right or wrong? It was wrong. Whether she is a Muslim or a Christian. All of us failed to stand behind her. Now people calling her secular, liberal, wow, wow. Where are you? When she was hit. Will you left her to somebody else to nurture her, to grow her, to make her a star? This is what we need to look at, the justice and the rights of every citizen in the country. Do you have the right of education for education? Yes, you are. As a woman? Yes, you have. As a man? Yes, we have. As a, from this clan or this clan or this clan, yes, we have the right, because I'm a citizen. So you stand next to me because I only represent you. This is not humanitarian. This is not development. This is not social rights. That we actually need to help ourselves to come out from our ghettos and to see what's happening outside, in the outside world. Because we are not living alone. Third point is partnership. Partnership. We have to go other organizations like us and build these bridges with them. Work together. Because we should look, our focal point is the community, not the fund that we want to raise. Okay? And we keep research as the basis of our success. One of the partnerships to do is academia. So they can save a lot of money and they can raise a lot of money. If you give them what they call it, fact-based research paper on certain issues, people will respond to it. There's many things which we're not doing in the past, we should be doing nowadays. Opening up, I will strongly extend the vision to go and be in conferences to listen. We have a volunteer program, not just one day, not just an event, real volunteer. This was our dream with Asif Shirazi Bai in 14 years ago. When we wanted, because we found that most of the people we get from outside the humanitarian sector are, sorry to say it, I'm saying it to these people here. You are a waste of time. And I refused to accept CVs from certain top organizations because they are more than bureaucrat and government. They don't have any innovation. I have to build this human capability, human leadership from within my organization. It's not a sandwich course. It's tarbiya and mentoring and guiding and developing their characters to become the future leaders. If you invest in somebody like myself, I'm a waste of time. Because I have a rigid mind now, خلاص. I'm in the 60s. Very difficult to change my mind. But if I go to the young people in the secondary school and the university, and I start to build them for the coming 10 or 20 years, you will make the social change. And you will make the impact. And you will guide and guard the 70% or 50% or 20% of your natural resources. Because those people are not infested by corruption, by division, they're still having the clear and the clean hearts, and you can actually make them to be the future leaders on the country. Any more? Unless the food is there and people are, you can value the food better, especially kebab, samosa, kofta. You eat kofta. I don't know what kofta mean, but you eat kofta.
Yeah.
Yes, brothers, sisters, brother, sister, a brother like a sister, a sister like a brother. What's the problem? Yes, you came late. Ask question. Don't me, because then you me, I you.
Let me take my question.
I put you on the spot, don't fail. See, I'm pointing my finger to you, threatening you, frightening you, scaring you.
Yes, you are. You're quite successful in it.
And it's getting you.
Yeah.
Don't cry now. You have to go above it and come back and say yes.
Yes. I don't have an answer right now.
Any question? Youth, rural development, water, sanitation, community building.
Okay, water crisis.
How
can we help in water crisis?
Okay, fine. Answer. The boss. See? What I'm saying is actually, she has the knowledge, but she has to stand on the stage to have the confidence to deliver what she can. Don't hesitate. Don't blink. See, I'm staring at you. Staring and scaring. Asif.
Yeah, I think the best thing is that if we can have an introduction, because Dr. Hani should know the other names also, that he can ask from other people also.
You can't get away from the answer, huh? Anyone has an answer for the system? Water problem.
So still, the crisis can be mitigated by as Dr. Shah said, that you have to manage the resource. It's, if you can look at it like crisis, or you can look at it whether it's a resource. You can manage it and you can make it a strength rather than a weakness. And you can build upon your...
So you talk about water management. Somebody yesterday was talking in Balochistan about, in Kota, about water netting.
Water netting?
Yeah. I loved the name, but I did not know what does mean. I know that my mother used to knit curtains,
yeah.
Knit
sweaters
and others. But this coming from a government bureaucrat to save water.
Is it something kind of...
I don't know.
What
could be whatever it is. This kind of thing, when you need to go back to the water department and the government, tell them what do you mean by water netting. Mm-hmm. Okay? Thank you, sister. You succeed. Any other questions? Yes, brother.
I enjoy or enjoy.
For this, I mentioned briefly a word called external relation. If our relation is just a group of people inside the country of X or Y or Z, is our money spent only on a certain plan, in a certain zone, with only organization that we prefer, not the general grassroots organization that we have? This organization, I did have to ask myself the question, have I been approachable to those community-based organizations? Have I been making partnership with them and letting them to be known to me and me to not be known to them or not? Those small organizations will be the first source of knowledge to any secret service in the government. So they go behind our program and they ask X organization, was asking the question. If they don't find that your presence is effective and impacting, and your presence only in one area where it suits your ideology, where it suits your morality or values, they will say you are not here working for the whole country,
yes,
or for the needy. You are coming here with a semi-political agenda which is covered by humanitarian work. This was exactly what happened in the Darfur crisis in 2004, when the government there in Sudan discovered that handful of this organization there, as the government claimed, well, actually their work or their agenda was not humanitarian. Okay, so here I can stand next to the government to give me the license. Your license is not to support only your group, but if you want to support one group, you put in your application form, I am here for this group. Here, the government will know that you are come here for this A or B or C. But if we say that I'm here for the country, and it becomes that not the country, but it's only one area, this is where you get the Secret Service to write a negative report about the INGO. This is something. On a country which have got a lot of security issues, okay? In such a country, you have to be very sensitive yourself when you work. You have to be very sensitive. Before the earthquake in Kashmir in 2005, Kashmir was a no-go area to any organization. That's right?
Yeah. Before that, yes.
Before that. They have to open up because of the calamity,
yes,
and the area there. From 2005 up to now, have the INGO, who have the privilege to work in this area, Yani respected the local culture, respected the politics of the area and the security of the area or not? Because while you are working in this area, people are watching us, especially in a conflict zone or a very sensitive area where the government is actually having to be scared by any foreigners to come here. And this is not only happening in Pakistan, it's happening everywhere, globally. Okay? That's why, come back to the partnership. First to be with partnership started with you. I am the boss. He is the boss. Okay? First level of partnership or circle of partnership is to be built with the colleagues in the office to make the team. Then you can go from the team to the local community. Then you can go from the local community to the organization like us. In Kashmir, in Baluchistan, in Sindh, to exchange. Because the information we have does not belong to Muslim Aid or Islamic League. It belongs to the community.
Yes.
Then we can go to the local government. Then we can go to any other department in the country to make them to feel happy that we are building this kind of relationship, building this kind of work there. So let the government to have the first-hand information from yourself, particularly if you're INGO, because they will have the information from somebody else.
Yeah.
And when they have it, it will be too late for you to defend yourself. Because I could write a negative report about you, because I don't like you. And I'm a civil servant. But once it goes to the government, it's very difficult to change this data on the computer. So you voluntarily give the information to the government offices before somebody else gave it negative or positive.
Any other questions?
I will buy your video because you are very stable. What's she working for?
HR administration.
Give me a question before I go home. You know, I got her on the spot. And she managed to swim.
I heard so much about you and I was really looking forward to the session with you. And you were one of the best person that they might have been taught by you. Shahnawaz Ali and Asif Shirazi and the Jandi Malik, they all are connected here, watching you. I'm happy to read the comments. So, at the moment, I'm just feeling very overwhelmed. Don't have any such question.
So I'll tell you something about myself.
Yeah.
I'm the worst manager. Very bad manager. Very what?
Manager.
No, yeah, what the word before manager? Very what?
Bad.
Bad. Okay? So don't work with me, because I make you mad. I make you mad.
I have a question for you.
But this sector
I'll make you mad.
No, but this sector needs madness, I guess.
But over madness, is overdose is maybe poisoning or break your back or make you mad. Okay? So sometimes that what actually could be a good leader, but not a good manager. Very, very few become good leaders and good managers at the same time.
So true.
Yeah. So I'm a very bad manager.
But a good leader, at least.
Oh, we don't know.
Yeah, you're a good
leader. We don't know, don't know. Yes, brother, last question, because the lunch is coming.
Yes.
And kebab is cold now.
What was the basic core value that drove you all these years and you have been in this leading role and you've been very good for in this sector? What was that basic core thing that triggered this drive inside you?
I think when we started in 1984, we did not think about anything apart from helping the people in Africa. Nothing else. Simple message. Simple message.
So all these years, this thing help. Kept you going. What was that?
Yeah, it will keep, anyone going. I tell you something, it depends on when you go to the field office. What do you want to see? If you want to see some images, you'll come back empty-handed with a lot of files of photographs. But if you want to see and feel the agony of the people and look at their agony and try to find the solution, you'll come back motivated. Driven by the issue and the cause, and you'll become the change maker. It's entirely up to you. That's why I said, it is a heart. I want to go there, because I'm going to stay for 7 days. Each day I take a per diem, and I'm going to make a report, and the report gives back. It will be a good report, but does not have a spirit. But if I want to go and live the issue for the people, you know how to live the issue with the people? When they sit down on the floor, and your clothes become dusty, okay? When they come closer to you and they are not scared that they infect you, when you shake their hands and they're not scared of any flea or lice to jump from their hair to your nice clothes, when you don't wear very nice clothes before going there, when you talk about the issue, not about your achievement, when you lower yourself down to the ground so they can elevate you. This is what we call it humility. This is where you come back charged. And when you are charged, you charge the people around you. And you elevate them. And you don't sleep. In some of the journeys, we used to work for 19 to 20 hours every day. This was Niger, Mali, Chad in 2007. 19 to 20 hours every day. No money was for it. Even in the good old days, Those people, including Shahnawaz and Asif and Jangir and Anwar, they do all the dirty jobs. On your bike. Do it. One day we're doing some Qurbani in Iraq, and I have a volunteer coming from USA, from California, and he's very good looking man and very smart and so on and so on. Every day going to the shower for about half an hour or 1 hour or 2 hours, whatever it is. On that day we're buying all the sheep, and he did not put his hand to make it dirty. You know what I have done to him? I hold the sheep, I said, so and so, hold. I hand it to him. He had to.
Seriously.
And when he looked after that at his white t-shirt, he came down to go and carry the sheep and go with the truck and go to slaughter them. But you have to come out of this. You have to be people's man. You have to let yourself to be able to listen to them, not to lecture them. Big difference. Listen. Listen to find the solution. At every sentence being mentioned to you by one of those people in this area, there's a solution for your problem and for your program. Okay? And you be charged.
Doctor, show your hands and you know these small things always keep him charged. This is the memory he's taking from Balochistan on this trip.
Cold weather, dusty weather, huh? And dry, cold, and dusty, and windy. Yesterday I was in the middle of the villages wearing the overcoat. And you can imagine those people who didn't have overcoat, young girls and boys.
Yeah, I've seen that picture, and a few of the individuals were wearing no sweaters as well.
Yeah, but I was cold.
Yeah, you were cold and you were, yeah, I've seen that.
You understand? So, hey, this is you relate yourself to them. If you relate yourself to them, they will have the power to charge the battery in your heart. Because the battery in your heart is not lifelong. When you are in heaven, it will be lifelong. But when you are here on earth, you need somebody to recharge your battery every now and then. The charger is those people who are in this area. Keep putting the wire in your heart through their smile, through their dua, and through their blessing to you. This will come to you, your family, your future as well, and your health, and your wealth. Got it? Are you charged now?
Yeah.
Jump, come on, jump from the window.
Food is ready.
That's it. Better. The talk is over. Now time for now another kind of food for thoughts.
No, it's food for stomach, you know.
And for thoughts,
inshallah.
Jazakumullah khair. Thank you very much. So-